Welcome! In this video, I'll be discussing the selection sort algorithm for sorting lists of items. Selection sort is one of the simplest sorting algorithms out there, both conceptually and implementation-wise, which makes it a good starting point for new learners. Let's go ahead and get started. The idea behind selection sort is based on dividing the original list into two sections, sorted and unsorted. One by one, the minimum element from the unsorted section is moved to the sorted section, until all elements have been moved. For example, say we want to sort these cards in ascending order from smallest to largest. We have our original list, which we assume is unsorted, and a sorted section that is initially empty. We start by moving the two of clubs to the sorted section because it's the smallest. Now we look for the next smallest in the unsorted section, which is the four of clubs. So we move that. Then 6, and finally 7. We now have a sorted list. This works fine, but programmatically the sorted section translates to an additional array, which uses up unnecessary space. It's not a big deal for our tiny list of 4 elements, but if we have a much larger list, say 10,000 elements, we would need space to store double that amount, 20,000. Let's take a look at how we can modify this into an in-place sorting algorithm, one that takes away the need for an extra array. Here we have an array containing the same 4 cards from the previous example, and like before, the whole list is initially labeled as unsorted. Even if the list were already sorted, our program wouldn't know it until it checks each one. We'll first step through this with some high-level pseudocode to get the concept down. The outer loop kicks things off by setting the current slot to index 0, because that's where the unsorted section begins. The inner loop finds that the 2 of clubs is our minimum element, so we place it in the current slot by swapping it with whatever card is already there, in this case, 6. 2 now becomes part of the sorted section, so it's no longer considered in our search for the minimum. The current slot gets incremented to index 1, and now we look for the next smallest number in the unsorted section, which is 4. We move that to the current slot, and now 4 becomes part of the sorted section too. Once again, increment the current slot to index 2 and find the minimum, which is 6. 6 is already in the current slot, so there's no need to swap this time. Finally, 6 is added to the sorted section and our job is done. We don't need to bother with the 7 because the last element will always be in its proper place. It can't go anywhere else. The list is now sorted. Now we'll walk through this same process with some actual C++ code and a different set of cards. I represents the current slot, which starts off at index 0. We set the minimum index to a default value equal to I, so we have something to compare against. This will keep track of where the minimum element is stored. Next, we step into the inner loop, where J represents the index being tested for the minimum element. J starts at index I plus 1, which is 1, so we ask the question, is 5 less than our current minimum 3? No, so J is incremented to index 2. Is 4 less than 3? No, so increment J to index 3. Is 3 less than 3? Once again, the answer is no, so we increment J to index 4. Ah, finally, 2 is less than 3, so we update the position of our minimum element to index 4, which is the current value of J. Now we exit the inner loop and check to see if 2 is already in the current slot. If not, swap it with whatever is there, in this case, the 3 of diamonds. 2 now becomes part of the sorted section and we start the whole process again, this time starting from index 1. With 5 as our new default minimum, we step back into the inner loop and start comparing. Is 4 less than 5? Yes, so we set min index to 2. Is 3 less than 4? Yes, so it's updated again to index 3. Is 3 less than 3? No, so the 3 of clubs remains as our minimum. It's not already in the current slot, so it's swapped with 5 and now part of the sorted section. Now 4 becomes our default minimum. Is 5 less than 4? Nope. How about 3? Yes, it is, so that's our new minimum. Swap it with 4 in order to place it in the current slot, and now we head to our final iteration. Is 4 less than 5? Yes, so we swap those two elements, leaving us with only one card left in the unsorted section. But remember, the last remaining element is always in its correct position, so we're finished. The list is sorted. Okay, time to conclude this tutorial with a quick analysis of the algorithm. I'll structure this around four key properties of sorting algorithms: time complexity, space complexity, stability, and adaptability. First up, time complexity using big O notation. In short, time complexity measures how long it takes for an algorithm to complete relative to input size n, and big O notation describes the max or worst case of that measurement. With that said, let's turn our attention to the code. The phrase relative to input size n tells us that we should mainly consider loop statements or recursive calls that involve n. Here we have two loops, one nested inside the other. The statements in the inner loop execute n-1 times for I equals 0, n-2 times for I equals 1, n-3 times for I equals 2, and so on. This turns out to be an arithmetic progression, which equals n times n-1 over 2. Written in polynomial form, it evaluates to n squared minus n over 2. However, big O notation only cares about the highest order term of a polynomial, so the time complexity of selection sort is order n squared, which is worst case. And because selection sort makes a fixed number of comparisons based on n, the best case always makes the same number of comparisons as the worst case. So the best case and average case also turn out to be order n squared as well. Next up, space complexity also using big O notation. Because this is an in-place sorting algorithm, it doesn't require any extra space, so it's order 1. Or said differently, it requires a constant amount of additional space. Stability. A sorting algorithm is stable if the initial order of equal elements is preserved. Because selection sort swaps elements to random locations, it is not a stable algorithm. We actually saw an example of this in our C++ demonstration. Initially, the 3 of diamonds was positioned before the 3 of clubs, but this was not the case in the end state. Adaptability. A sorting algorithm is adaptive if it can take advantage of the initial order, improving performance the more the list is already sorted. Selection sort is not an adaptive algorithm because it makes a fixed number of comparisons based on n, regardless of whether the list is initially sorted or not. No early exit condition. In conclusion, selection sort is not a very efficient sorting algorithm, particularly with large lists since it's order n squared for all cases. And although it usually performs better than bubble sort because of far fewer needed swaps, insertion sort is normally the preferred alternative. I hope this tutorial was helpful and easy to understand. The next video will cover the bubble sort algorithm. Thanks for watching!